In this video, there will be many pages of various limits to be finding for calculus 1. So, to start out, we have a limit as x approaches 0 of sine of 5x over x cosine of 3x. My first inclination here is to look at where the limit is going. The limit is going to 0, and I see we have a sine of 5x over x. So if I can somehow get myself a sine x over 5x, then I can definitely send that part of the limit to 1 as a special trig limit. So what I'm going to do here in red is circle what I'm going to need for the special trig limit, and I'm going to write that off to the side. So sine of 5x over x, that's what I have. And the rest of this is the limit as x approaches 0 of 1 over cosine 3x. So like I said, we're really close in having that sine of 5x over 5x. What I need to do is divide this sine x 5x by a 5. So I want to do that like this. I want to put 5 down here with x. So I'm multiplying this whole big fraction here by a 5 in the denominator. So I've got to do the same in the numerator. So now this part goes to 1, and this part I can substitute the 0 in for x. And that's just because the cosine of 3 times 0 is the cosine of 0 is 1. So this leaves me with, a 5 over cosine of 3 times 0. Which is 5 over 1, which is 5. For the next limit, I've got the limit as x approaches infinity of this rational expression, 3x squared minus 5x over 4 minus 2x cubed. And since this limit has x going to infinity, I know I'm going to use this technique that x cubed, since that is the 3 is the degree of the bottom, I want to divide every term in the denominator by x cubed and every term in the numerator by x cubed. So that's going to look something like this. You have the limit as x approaches infinity of 3x squared minus 5x all over 4 minus 2x cubed, and all of these are going to be divided by x cubed. Anytime x goes to infinity, you want to divide all terms by the highest power of x in the denominator. So then we can simplify this. This is the limit as x approaches infinity of this expression here. And from here, you know that as x gets really, 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 really big, 3 over x gets really, really close to 0. Same. It's like this has a vertical or horizontal asymptote of 0. This has a horizontal asymptote of 0. This has a horizontal asymptote of 0. So we can write something like this. This goes to 0. This goes to 0. This goes to 0. So we're left with 0 minus 0 over 0 minus 2, which is 0. On this page, we have an example, the limit as x approaches 4 of x minus 4 over 2 minus the square root of x. One thing that I didn't point out yet was that if you have a real number here and not an infinity, you can go ahead and substitute that in. Why not? Just see what happens. That'll give you 4 minus 4 over 2 minus square root of 4, which in the denominator is really 2 minus 2. So this leaves you with a 0 over 0. And that is your hint that the expression can be simplified somehow in order to make possible a substitution of 4 in for x. So let's see what happens. Since I see a square root here, I want to rationalize this. So I want to multiply the top and bottom of this fraction by 2 plus the square root of x. That is what we call the conjugate pair. So that'll look something like this. So I multiply top and bottom by 2 plus square root of x. And so now we can rewrite this limit, the limit as x approaches 4 of x minus 4 times 2 plus square root of x. And I urge you not to multiply these two binomials together. We didn't multiply numerator and denominator by 2 plus square root of x, so you could distribute this out. We multiplied by this so we could simplify the denominator. And in the denominator, you're left with 4 minus x. Now, it might not look like it immediately, but there's something here that cancels very specially. We have a factor x minus 4, and there's a factor 4 minus x that's in the denominator. These factors have the same two terms, an x and a 4. They're both differences, so x minus 4 and 4 minus x. But the terms are in the exact opposite order, x minus 4, 4 minus x. When that happens, you can reduce these factors to a negative 1. So if you divide this negative 1 into each term, you'll get the following limit. The limit as x approaches 4 of negative 2 minus the square root of x. So now, finally, we can substitute in that 4 and get negative 4 for the final answer. That's negative 2 minus the square root of 4, which would just be 2. Negative 2 minus 2 more is negative 4. Over here on the right side, you can see we have the limit as x approaches infinity of sine of square root of x over square root of x. Now you might be very inclined to call this infinity, call this limit 1. And that is because this limit, this expression, you're used to seeing as a special trig limit as x goes to 0. And as you see here, this x does not go to 0, it goes to infinity. So this limit is not 1. The best way to explain how this limit happens is in the following manner. I can tell you that the sine of the square root of x, and this is for almost any expression you want to put inside of a sine, is always going to be less than or equal to 1, but also greater than or equal to negative 1. So now, to make this middle expression look like what we have, I'm going to divide everything, all three parts of this inequality, by the square root of x. So everything is still legal here. The next thing I want to do is take the limit of all of these. The limit as x approaches infinity of negative 1 over, and I'm going to rewrite this as x to the 1/2 power. That's less than or equal to the limit as x approaches infinity of the sine of the square root of x over the square root of x. It's less than or equal to the limit as x approaches infinity of 1 over x to the 1/2 power. So the sine of the square root of x over the square root of x is always between these two values. So if we take the limit of all three of them as x goes to infinity, you can see that by the little theorem used on the last page, that one negative 1 over x to some positive power, this limit is 0. And over here, all the way on the right, we have the limit as x goes to infinity of some constant over x to a positive power. The limit of this is 0. The only possible place for this limit to go in the middle here is 0. So the limit as x approaches infinity of sine of square root of x over the square root of x is in fact 0. On this page, two more limits. We have the limit as x approaches infinity of 2x minus 3 all over the square root of 3 plus 2x squared. And for this limit, we need to know a couple facts. Like in the denominator, since x is going to infinity, we need to find the biggest power of x in the denominator. And it looks like the biggest power is 2. Except this really isn't a second power. This is going to be a first power because this square and this square root are acting upon the same x. So really it's like an x to the first power. And here's how we can relate this to what's going to happen in the denominator and what's going to happen in the numerator. So we have in the denominator, we're going to divide all the terms by the square root of x squared. Now in the numerator, it doesn't make any sense for us to divide by a square root of x squared because there's no square root in the numerator. We have just a regular old linear expression in the numerator. So what I want to do is I want to put this square root of x squared in terms of something linear. Well, the definition of what happens when you have the square root of x squared is that you get the absolute value of x. And since the limit is going to positive infinity, we will set that absolute value of x equal to positive x. And that's because x is approaching positive infinity. So this last equality happens because x is approaching positive infinity. That's why the absolute value of x will be equal to positive x. So in the denominator, what's happening is we have the limit as x approaches infinity of the square root of 3 plus 2x squared all over x squared. And again, these square roots in red are also, or these x squareds in red are also inside of a square root. So yes, we are dividing the highest power of x inside the square root by the highest power of x, also inside of a square root. In the numerator, we've got this 2x over x minus 3 over x. So when you simplify all these x's, you get the limit as x approaches infinity of 2 minus 3 over x all over the square root of 3 over x squared plus 2. And so just like before, this term will go to 0. This term will also go to 0 as x goes to infinity. So we're left with 2 over the square root of 2. On the right side of this page, we have the limit as x approaches 0 from the right of negative 2 cosine x all over sine of 5x. So again, we can take this 0 and substitute it in right away to see what happens. So the cosine of 0 is 1. 1 times negative 2 gives you a negative 2 in the numerator. And in the denominator, you have the sine of 5 times 0. 5 times 0 is 0. The sine of 0 is 0. Now, I mentioned on the previous slide, if you have 0 over 0, this expression can be simplified. However, if you have any other number over 0, this expression is not simplified. Not that it can't be simplified, but this expression is approaching a vertical asymptote. So what you want to do here is pick a number very close to 0, because that's what x is approaching. Maybe 0.001. And you want to substitute that into the expression you are trying to find the limit of. So that would be negative 2 cosine 0.001 all over sine of 5 times 0.001. So the cosine of 0.001 is a positive number. Times negative 2 gives you something negative. So I know that I'm going to have a negative result in the numerator. In the denominator, since this sine is being evaluated very close to 0, but just to the right of 0, I know that result will be positive. And a negative divided by a positive will give you a negative answer. So we need this sign. That's what we're looking for. So now we can say this. The limit as x approaches 0 from the right of negative 2 cosine x over sine 5x is negative infinity. In this example, we have a piecewise function, the limit, and we're trying to find the limit as x approaches 1 from the left of g of x, where g of x is this function x over x plus 2 if x is less than or equal to 1, and negative 2 over x minus 1 if x is greater than 1. And since we are approaching this limit, this limit value 1 from the left, this limit is exactly the same thing as writing the limit as x approaches 1 from the left of this part of the function, x over x plus 2. And that is because this part of the function exists to the left of 1, less than 1. So now we can just substitute this number 1 right in for x and get a final answer of 1 over 3. On this page, we have two more limits. The first one being the limit as x approaches 1 from the left of 3x minus 3 over the absolute value of x minus 1. So the first thing you want to do here is remember that this absolute value function, x minus 1, equals x minus 1 if x is greater than or equal to 1, and negative x minus 1 if x is less than 1. And again, you can find this value for x, where this domain break is, by setting the insides equal to 0 and solving for x. That's where this 1 comes from. So since we are approaching this from the left, that would mean we're using this function down here. So I can rewrite this limit as the limit as x approaches 1 from the left of 3x minus 3 over negative x minus 1. And then to make this easier on myself, I'm going to common factor a 3 from the numerator. So So this is the limit as x approaches 1 from the left of 3 times x minus 1 all over negative x minus 1. So now it looks like these x minus 1s will reduce away, and you'll just be left with 3 over negative 1, which in fact is just negative 3. And I want to point out very quickly again that if you take this 1 and substitute it in here, we will end up with 3 times 1 is 3 minus 3 over the absolute value of 1 minus 1, which ends up being 0 over 0. And what this 0 over 0 tells you is that later on somewhere, in fact right here, we were able to simplify the expression enough to where we could get an answer analytically. And so I want to start this next example like that. I want to take this 2 and substitute it in there, there, and there. And so I'll end up with a 2 minus 4 in the numerator and a 4 because it's 2 squared, minus 2 minus 2 in the denominator. And this gives me a negative 2 over 0. So there's no simplification happening here. What is really happening is that since this numerator is negative 2, that means we're approaching a vertical asymptote. If that numerator were 0, like this last one, we could have simplified something. But because we have something that's not 0, we have to just pick something close. So something close to 2 from the left side of 2 would be, let's pick 1.999. So for this example, we need 1.999 minus 4 all over 1.999 squared minus 1.999 minus 2. And in the numerator, I know that 1.999 minus 4 definitely gives me something negative. And when you simplify what's in the denominator, 1.999 squared minus 1.99 minus 2, you very barely get something that's negative. It's something like negative 0.0029, so on. So that's a really small negative number, but it is negative. And so this fraction here is a negative divided by a negative. Anytime you divide a negative by a negative, you get a positive. So this is positive. We need this ending sign. So now we can say the limit as x approaches 2 from the left of x minus 4 over x squared minus x minus 2 is positive infinity. In these last two examples for this video, I've got the limit as x approaches negative infinity of cosine of negative 3 over x squared. And even though this negative 3 over x squared is inside of the cosine, as x goes to negative infinity, this still follows the rule that it's going to go to 0. So this limit turns into the cosine of 0, which is 1. Easy enough. So this next example, the limit as x approaches negative 3. Ooh, goodness, it's not a one-sided limit. It's a two-sided limit of this expression. And just for funsies, I want to do this here and see what I get. So when you substitute that negative 3 in, the numerator turns into 9 minus 15 plus 6 all over. The denominator turns into 18 minus 15 minus 3, which, if you simplify numerator and denominator, is 0 over 0. So that means this expression simplifies somehow. I'm guessing since we have two quadratic expressions that it'll be by factoring and canceling. So I'll have the limit as x approaches negative 3 of x plus 2 times x plus 3. There we go. All over 2, 3, 2x minus 1 times x plus 3. And you can almost tell that it's going to be the x plus 3 or some multiple of this factor, x plus 3, because this is where the limit's trying to go, negative 3. That's what makes the denominator and numerator 0. So we can get rid of it. There we go. The limit as x approaches negative 3 of x plus 2 over 2x minus 1. Now we can directly substitute that in there and get the final answer of negative 1 over negative 7, which is 1 over 7. And because you lasted all the way to the end of this video, you will now get to hear a song.